Hey, Grace.
Hi, it's so nice. Nice to finally meet you, kind of.
Yeah, sort of face-to-face, sort of.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
So I have to say, superhero content, it's everywhere.
Yes.
As the mastermind behind the Boys TV show, what in your mind sets it apart?
Well, really, because it really explores what a truly terrible idea superheroes in the real world would be. It's a bad idea. So, our angle is we take this idea of superheroes and we put them basically in our world, and we try to apply the most stringent reality we can, which is the truth is they would be Uber celebrities, and corporations would grow around them to monetize them. And they would be with so much access and enabling and broken homes, they would all be intensely flawed people that you're basically handing atomic weapons to. So that's just the truth of what would happen, because people are people.
Yeah, everything else gets messed up. Why not superheroes?
You know, and just the idea, and you know, there would be good ones, but there would be a lot of bad ones. It's just an attempt to deconstruct it a little bit by applying reality.
Well, speaking of companies, and there's an amazing scene in season 2, episode 1, between Homelander and Giancarlo Esposito's Stan Edgar. And you wrote it.
I did.
How can a human stand up to a god?
It's from Stan Edgar's perspective. Stan Edgar views them as children. I think up to this point, Homelander felt the company was about the management and coddling of superheroes. And I think Stan Edgar gives him the rude awakening that this is actually a very serious company that does weapons and pharmaceuticals and has an effect on the actual global economy. And you are the entertainment division. So we talked a lot about, like, this is how Rupert Murdoch must have felt about, you know, Fox Searchlight. You know, it's just a small little fucking bit, you know.
Disney, the movies are like the third biggest performing division.
Yeah, it's just some small little division of his shit. And so that, to me, and I think he views them as spoiled liabilities, which is why he can stand up to them. And ultimately, Homelander can't do anything about it because Edgar signs his checks.
Well, finally, you made a lot of changes to Stormfront.
Yeah.
You know, she's not only a woman, but she's a strong feminist. Also, she's from Portland, which is quite in the news right now.
Yeah.
What were your goals in updating her as a character?
A couple of reasons. Someone asked, like, well, what was she doing when season 1 was happening? And I was like, oh, well, she's in Portland throwing people into unmarked vans. really, the two goals for her in terms of gender flipping the character were really twofold. One, we wanted to make her Homelander's worst nightmare, which would be a strong woman who wasn't afraid of him and was stealing his spotlight. That's the worst thing that could happen to him, because he's this gaping black hole of insecurity. So part of it was just to knock him on his ass. And then the other part of it is, anyone who reads the books knows that there's layers of her that are revealed that are pretty on the hateful side. And the book's depiction of that is sort of an old school version of that kind of hate, I would say. And the truth is in the modern world, a lot of hate and intolerance packages itself in this kind of attractive social media slick package and presents as, like, we're just free thinkers and, you know, we're not gonna just be sheeple. And so therefore we have all of these hateful ideas. And we wanted Stormfront to sort of reflect what hate looks like today versus what it looked like, you know, 20, 30 years ago.
I totally see that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, no, it was good talking to you.
Yes, it was so nice. See you.
Yeah, I'll see you online, Grace.